My granddad always had one day a week in bed. He would sit there for the day with his pipe and not get up, not for anything. One day, when I was three, he came into the living room and looked at Mother. "Right, Pat," he declared, "I'm going to bed, and I don't want to get up." He went upstairs, got into bed, and just shut down. He had literally just given up, and within a week, he was dead. He had become tired of life and didn't even want to see Nanny anymore, just my mother. "Get my beauty," he would demand to Nanny. I always remember him smoking a pipe and pottering about in the garden. On one occasion, he was cutting the holly bush, whilst smoking, of course, and he actually set it on fire. He was a lovely, gentle man, with a dry sense of humour. He walked in through the back door, puffing his pipe. "Pat," he said, quite casually, "the holly bush is on fire." "What?" exclaimed Mother. "The holly bush is on fire," he continued, without an ounce of panic. "We better phone the fire brigade." Dillis, ever the nutter, thought this was a brilliant opportunity for some fun. She was 6 years older than me and was always up for some mischief. I can't have been any more than about 3 years old. She bundled me into my pram and aimed me at the flaming holly bush. Mother caught sight of what was happening, let out a scream and saved me from the fiery peril, much to Dillis's dismay. I wasn't the sole target of my older sister's antics. She had a lovely boyfriend who came round to play and have dinner. One day, she took him into our garage and decided it would be fun to paint him from head to toe with green emulsion paint. Mother was, as you can imagine, not best pleased. Despite such strangeness, Dillis always looked after me as a kid and was always on my side, protecting me. I have always had a mortal fear of dogs, ever since I was a child. Other people's dogs, obviously, because I've had dogs of my own. Dillis decided she wanted to try and cure me of this phobia. And one day we were walking along Kendall Avenue when she spotted a man walking his Alsatian on the other side of the road. "Oh," she cooed, "let's go and pat the dog." Begrudgingly, I let her drag me across the road. "Isn't he lovely? Come and stroke him." "No, I don't want to," I replied rigidly. "Look, Debs, you've got to get over this dog thing," she said, organising me as ever. She marched up to the dog, rested her hand on his head, and it went for her, taking a chunk out of her leg. The screaming and the blood did little to cure my phobia. I used to hate going to school. I went to various different places before I ended up at the convent school. Dillis had to take me every day to make sure I went in. I used to cling on to her, screaming each morning, protesting that I wasn't going to go in. In retrospect, I think she had to put up with a lot from me. Parkston was the name of the convent school, and the nuns there just left me alone. They assumed, given my family background, that there wasn't much point in trying to teach me anything because I was going to be an actress, after all. Why would I need to know Boyle's Law or Pythagoras' Theorem? In some ways, it was great. "Excuse me, sister," I would ask innocently in the middle of a lesson. "Can I go out in the garden for a bit?" "Of course you can, Debbie," they would smile. It didn't teach me anything. On the flip side, having an acting background meant that they were very keen on using me to enter singing competitions around the country. I was usually quite good, and used to come first or second, and the nuns were very proud. One song I recall singing when I was about 8 was called Little Lucy Lavender. Little Lucy Lavender, age just 3, climbed up the apple tree. One of those very twee and very sweet little numbers, which I would perform acutely with all the actions. The nuns loved it, and they loved me too. They were so excited when I won the part in The Invisible Man, because they could see one of their girls on television. I got away with murder. Not that I was a badly behaved child. I was very good, inwardly at any rate. We had by this point moved away from Epping to Alderton Hall, Loughton. There were many sad memories attached to our time at Epping, greatest of those being my little baby brother, Adam, who died there. I was 3 years old when Mummy took Adam out into the garden for his afternoon rest to get some fresh air. It had been snowing, and she left him outside under the eaves of the house. She went back inside, and when she came out to bring him in, some snow had fallen from the roof above and smothered him. I was only 3 years old, but I can still vividly recall seeing my mother running past the kitchen window with Adam over her shoulder, his head lolling to one side. I sat on the floor playing with my toys, and even at that age, I knew he was dead. We were all distraught, but Mother especially, as she blamed herself totally. She came to terms with it, but never got over it. There was no way she could have known what was going to happen. It was a tragic accident. Not that people in the town saw it that way. A small minority sent disgusting hate mail, spiteful, nasty comments, which didn't help at all. Father was so concerned that he went to the doctor to see what he could do to assist. And the doctor said they should try for another child straight away, which they did. And 9 months later came along Giles. They really wanted another boy, and God looked down and granted their wish. From Epping, we moved briefly to a small lodge in Buckhurst Hill, on one of the main roads. It was the lodge house on the main estate there, but it was too cramped for the whole family to live in. Father wanted to buy a house in London, but couldn't find anything large enough. So for a while, Mother, Father and Dillis went to stay in a property in London, whilst Nanny, myself and Giles went back to Epping to live with my best friend Cynthia Wootton and her family. That meant that we were split up for a time, but used to visit London at the weekend, me dragging a reluctant Giles along on the tube, then back off on Sunday evening so we could be ready for school the next day. But it wasn't working, and Father soon realised that they would have to give up the house in London and look for something bigger outside. The London contingent came down to Epping for a change to stop with us one weekend. And Dillis, who was a keen horse rider, went out riding in the forest with Mother. They were riding quite happily along when all of a sudden there was a low-hanging branch. Dillis ducked under it, but Mother didn't spot it and was whipped straight off her horse onto the ground below. She lay on the ground in agony, and it transpired later that she'd actually broken her collarbone. "Don't worry, Mummy, don't worry," exclaimed Dillis. "I'll go and get some help." And off she shot on her horse. About 20 minutes later, there was a rustling in the bushes, and out marched a passing troop of Boy Scouts with their leader. They were overjoyed to find a real-life casualty, because they could put their survival training into practice. They cobbled together a stretcher with some branches and carried her to hospital. Dillis came back a short time later. Foul Mother had vanished and went into a complete blind panic. All was well, though, and the doctors were treating Mother nearby, but she was totally delirious. "Must get the family back together," she rasped, lapsing in and out of consciousness. "What's the matter, Mrs. Watling?" asked Mr. Bhattacharya, our family doctor. "Must get the family back together," she kept repeating. "Nowhere to live." "Don't worry about it. I've got the perfect place for you," he smiled reassuringly. "Alterton Hall." And that is how we found Alterton Hall, which became the family home for 29 years.